Welcome to the Query Knockout podcast. Thank you for tuning in again. We've got a special guest this week, Latrell Mitchell. Make sure you're subscribing to follow us on YouTube, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and follow us on Instagram and TikTok and everything as well too, because we share some great clips from the yarn that we have today. Great to have Trell on today. We've also got Tommy Tuck and Dino peeps. Widders here.
Mad on him.
He's mad on himself, actually. Actually, he's getting a bit of a follow on you.
No, this could be my last gig. The boys are getting off of me, so.
He reckon NRL 360 has been ringing.
Kenny's gone. Kenny's gone. He's back in.
School all days are coming up and they're about to renew my contract, so.
Tommy Kent, they reckon.
He's hit up fresh too.
No more chips and gravy. I can't get a free breakfast. It's all on That's the it. If you come next time, pay your own way.
Thanks for joining us.
No worries. Thanks, boys.
Do you know what? Let's open it. Let's open it with the official announcement. Give us the official announcement. Who is Latrell Mitchell playing for in the knockout in 2024?
I'm gonna just go back home. I think
mad.
Yeah, go back home, give back again, and it's been a few years now. So, but yeah, it depends on rep honours at the end of the year too. So that could. Yeah, sort of play a part as well. So
still going to manufacture the team.
Yeah, 100%. I'll want to get a good team together. I need some forwards out there, some fronties. So anyone that's looking to play,
you got a brother that's a decent front rower.
Yeah, with one front row. You want me to play front row too?
Satari,
yeah, I'm going back home. Yeah, and Big Shackers. Hopefully, you know, he's ready to go by then. But you know, get him back playing for South, and then I think he'll be cleared. And so
that's exciting. That's great news. I reckon that's real exciting South knockout this year.
You haven't got one big front row out there, Liam Simon, your cousin.
Yeah, I got Liam. Yeah he's a good. I got a few there. That's what I'm saying. So I want to get a few more. So
they all big at Tyree. What are you worried about? Front rowers.
A lot of front rowers, though.
Yeah, we need some fronties. So we're all, you know, Corey's all backs. You know, some of them just
lean on your connections, bros. You got a lot of connections there.
I'll tell you what, though.
Jermaine Opgood, you ready?
There you go.
You got a lot of followers there. Would love to go and play with you.
Kerr. Oh yeah. Anyone?
All right, that'll do. There.
SOS. SOS. I need just.
Chris Smith said he wasn't playing.
Chris Smith. See, look.
But we talk about size. Talk about front rows. Some of our best performing clips from previous knockout podcasts are talking about the Tyree front rowers from.
Back in the day.
80s and early 90s.
Yeah, that'd be before my time, but Dad used to always talk about mad yarns and how deadly these fellas was. And obviously Uncle Dan was a big man, so you know, all the Bungie boys are all big, tall lads and just thick, eh? So Dad used to always tell mad yarns. Yeah, that's it.
He was a big man, big Dennis, but he was hard too and ferocious and aggressive and just an intimidator on the football field. And I played against South Tyree, I played against your dad. And they were a very passionate team.
Oh, yeah.
Very passionate team. And you knew that they were going to come out no matter who was in their side, no matter who you had in your team, and they were going to give it. But it's something that all people from that area is very proud of, is the South Tyree.
Yeah, well, I think just passion is a big thing. Obviously, rugby league's in our blood up there and, like, anywhere. But for me, knowing where I'm from and all my mob and before me, that's why I played footy, because all the dad's yarns and then playing with the Shaq, playing with Lionel and then – you know, then obviously now I can make a career out of it. It's just I know they're looking down now, and you know how proud they would be, I reckon. And
100%.
Yeah, I'm a grandfather too, and you know, it's just it's awesome to think back and you know be the, you know, one of the first to sort of make a dream out of it. And yeah, very happy, and it's always a privilege to represent Tyree and all mobs all over. But yeah, just coming from there and how passionate we are about footy, and yeah, and I still show it to this day. So.
I want to give this fellow a rap too when we start, because he was in Melbourne for the Origin game there last week and obviously went to Tyree the next morning, but then he showed up in Armidale that night.
I'm not going back. Too cold, new mob. I told you that.
That's what we're talking about. Freezing, cold. Man. I knew someone was saying about
cause it. I went there. It was cold, man. It was freezing. So I don't know. I said, Dino, why is it so cold, man?
He came to the dinner that night there, and it was obviously been a long day for him. And then the next day at the clinic, and he just made sure that no kid missed out from his a photo. And there's that many good people coming. But I think they're only supposed to have 100 people there, players registered.
Mate, yeah,
they had about 200.
They come from Gunnedah, Tamworth, where else? Tinga.
Oh, they come from everywhere.
It was mad. Like, what, we only were meant to register, what? And then they 100, just said,
and there was extras everywhere. And the kids come in late and families come in late, and he was still giving autographs and photos like hours after it sort of finished. I know how much it meant to him, but these kids will brag about that. They were still talking about the next day. The buzz in the town was unbelievable. Yeah, so I've got to give him a rap there.
That's unreal.
Love how he goes about it. He does the work, But I also love how he goes about it because he just makes sure that every kid, no matter the ones that miss out, he grabs them in and gives them a bit of thing. They loved it.
I had a little, couple of little fellas crying there because I couldn't get to them in time, but then I end up, you know, by the end of it getting them and they were good. So I sorted them out.
That's a hard thing though too, I suppose, because you've obviously got your own schedule that you've got to stick to and you've got to go somewhere.
Oh, it's
so
not easy.
Hard that you can't
I just think people have to realise that, you know, I can't get everyone. I'd love to and I try to. But yeah, like I said, it just
You do a great job.
Yeah,
you do a my best.
Yeah, exactly.
And it isn't easy because everyone there's thousands there. And they know who he is and stuff like that. But he's trying to see everyone. He doesn't know that he's missed some kids and stuff. But he made every attempt to see them all.
You don't have enough.
It takes a lot out of you. Those
you get a couple of people double dipping.
Yeah, I don't
realize.
I just one little girl there. She was a little curry one, and she did like five times, and she just had something different every time. Oh, my cousin, my uncle, you know, someone.
They get the hat. They got a shirt. Yeah. They get your boot.
The community loved it. They appreciated it.
It was really good. I really enjoyed it. We did a few of the little clinics and that. Like, obviously, it's a couple of drills, and the kids just loved it. They were respectful. And, you know, Tari is probably one of the best clinics we run. And then going up there, that turnout up in Armidale was probably one of the best turnouts. So,
have to come to Tamworth next. My town.
Yeah, what was a better town, Tari?
Tari was way better.
Come to Tamworth. It's too long
for him in Armidale.
Love you, Armidale, Marvel Tayers. All my people there. But,
they are a good crew up there, Armidale.
It was very cold. Yeah, they cold-blooded up too. It's cold.
Let's talk a little bit about that old Tari team. Did you get to see much of your father play? Because I hear a lot of people talk about Matty Mitchell and how good of a
footballer. When I was a bit younger, I think growing up, about 6, 7, like when you sort of start to, you know, remember a little bit, but that's as far as I can sort of remember when I was catching the back end of that sort of career where he was playing for Bulls, playing for Old Bar and that. So, and then he had a game with Wingham. I would have been about 11, 12, I reckon, where I remember him playing for Wingham. And so he's gone, you know, he's won a few comps and up there locally. And but yeah, I've only heard, you know, good stories about, you know, what good player he was back in the day, and 5'8" running around, and now he's in a front row mold. So I wanted to have a game with him and knock it. That was a goal between all four of us or the boys, but
must have been close.
Yeah, we were real close, but yeah, Dad, I think just got too comfy farming now. So,
when was your first knockout game?
Yeah, 2013, I think, maybe. 40.
How old were you then?
I'd have been 15, probably.
15
on the
years
wing.
Old.
Dad just let me play. He wasn't going to let me play.
We played with Minda.
I played with the wing,
at Raymond Terrace.
And what was it called? Nulla Dolphins. Me and Shaq played the juniors there, and then ended up playing with Tari for the men's. And now it worked.
Nice, because the kids played early.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
On a Friday. And then the next day you packed up, play for.
So Dad let me just play because he wouldn't let me play.
Oh, he would have to sign on for you.
Yeah.
Hey?
Did you say where it was?
Raymond Terrace. Yeah. But I remember it was against Wild, my first game, pretty sure.
Yeah, true.
Against you.
What do you remember from that game?
You growling around the sideline there trying to fight around the eyes in there.
Oh, nothing's changed.
Nah, I think Joy Mundine come off stressing and got sent off or something. And he was just, I think, Bob just had enough, he reckon, and started carrying on and arguing back. So that's my memory from knockout. And just debuting on the wing there and playing and having a crack. It was fun. Dad, you know, just let me play because I was only a little fella then, but I hit the growth spurt about a year after that.
So you hadn't had your growth spurt yet.
And that's with Shaq. Shaq was always a big fighter, so he was allowed to play, you know, and then I was just like, throw him on the wing there. Then.
Did Shaq play that game as well?
Yeah, he played that game.
What sort of hit-ups were you doing in that game? Were you dead down?
Yeah, catching it down. I was pretty fast too, so I was flying around.
Were you a bit confident too?
Yeah.
I played against your dad in, I think it was 2000 out at Dubbo, and him and Chrissy Morecambe were in the same team with Tari, and our Narwhal team, we won the knockout but we played them in the first game. It was our hardest game. I think it was a draw and we won through on the first round. but geez, Matty Mitchell was a real confident, like, brilliant ball player, could throw a mad long ball. When I see you come into a back line and throw that long pass that you hit the winger, and that's exactly how he was. He threw a beautiful long pass, bro, but with that same sort of confidence and stretch his neck out
and play the way you
throw that pass really reminds me of. But he was tough. He was very physical.
Yeah.
5'8". He was an aggressive player, and I was a second row lock, and he come out to try and kill me, Matty, when we played him. But him and Chrissy Morecambe, they had a good combination. Jeez, Matt knew how to use Chris. Chris
center,
was a big, strong centre. He was fast, and that was my big recollection of that Tari playing against Matty. And then also just how lovely a person Matty is off the field. I remember I met him when I was a young fellow because he'd lived with Wes and that when he first come down, and their family loves him. You know, all the Patton family loves Matty and talked all about him all the time. And then when I got in there, I met Matt, and he's just so good, such a good person. He's still the same. I run into him at Old Bar on the weekend. I sat down and mad yarn with him, and he told me about the boys and what's going on. And I brought a couple of mates over, and Matty just made them all feel comfortable. And then he made a point of going in and seeing little Kempsey halves after the game because he was impressed by the way they played.
Yeah, he said there was one little fella there, about 19 or something.
Yeah,
he said he went down for the Bulldogs.
Young Nemo from Kempsey, he played with McClay. He went and seen him after the game and just said, keep at it, bro, because we heard the young fella was at the Bulldogs and he went back and just trying to encourage him. And it was good Matty just made that effort, I guess. I just want to go in there and encourage him and keep at it, bro. You've got to be playing something else ahead of you.
I think Bo champion.
Yeah, Bo was their coach.
Yeah. So I told that to keep an eye out for me and let me know and see what we can do.
But that's Matty Mitchell, and you could see what he raised with Shaq and Latrell and Lionel and the family. You know, the family's beautiful. You know, it's great.
Yeah, no, great values. Dad's drilled them into us and just being good people, and obviously that pays you back in tons. And like I am now, like just giving back to as much as I can, that pays it forward. And, you know, that's all my dad's always taught us to just be, you know, you treat people the way you want to be treated. And, you know, and that's always, you know, stuck strong with us. And he's a good man, old fella. So I'm glad I get to look after him and give him another sort of lifestyle. And our farm having a crack, and he got lifted by one of the cows the other day. So he ain't got that short feet anymore. He's not too quick on his feet. But he said it was funny as one of my mates were telling me just getting chucked up against the cattle yards. And because they just haven't calved, see? So they're a bit more hesitant on, you know, being around someone, you know. So it was just, funny when he was telling me the yarn. But
he's better off in the sheds with old mate. Not the cow sheds. poor old Unc.
Yeah.
Let's talk a little bit about your footy, about your knockout history, because in the last few years, I mean, we've been lucky enough to have you play with us.
It's quite universal.
Down in Nowra.
Yeah.
He's a water boy.
I was.
Tell everyone how that came about, because we actually, leading into that knockout, we were bragging about how we had the best water boy at the knockout. We'd locked in the best water boy at the knockout.
Yeah, no, I was key, like obviously I had the World Cup coming up, so I was a bit, I'm an iron on that, whether they get playing. So I rang Mal and he said, yeah, you're right, bro, I was just playing. And I was like, didn't say nothing until sort of, you know, day one. And I was water boy up until then. And then I just said, oh, I may as well get a bit of match fitness and, you know, and it sort of put me in good stead after that, really, for the World Cup. But I just thought I'd come down, connect, because, you know, Wilgut, he's doing really well of being, you know, having that family orientation, and he's looked after each other, and, you know, especially at the hotels, looked after my little crew, and just see all the kids running around us or something. That was the best, man, and just having that one little hotel and all the kids just mucking up through it always was, something I really loved, and that made my mind up that night, really, having that. And I said, look, I'll have a crack, just, you know, I don't know nothing, but I just wanted to come and have a crack with you fellas, and, you know, people can say what they want, as they do with anyone, but I just love the fact of that family orientation and what you've done for me over time, and standing where I can pay it back was doing that. And I really enjoyed that, playing knockout and going to the final. Obviously we come one short to NAB, but enjoyable one where I didn't have to do too much. And, you know, I remember taking Tari to first semi against the RRB, and you know, in 2017, I think it was. So, you know, I was fresh NRL, but also, you know, fresh target as well on the head. So,
well, in that year at Nowra, because I remember that was, how many years did we miss? We missed 2 years of knockouts, eh?
1 year,
and then that was the first one back after. I think it was 2 years.
Two years it was,
And then that was the first one back.
Oh, that's
felt
when
like
itchy has to get
back. Even though we lost that grand final, I still left there that
felt satisfied. That
Like you said about the kids, I reckon the kids probably had a better time than us the whole week. Even they just played nonstop from Friday through to Monday, everywhere.
Talk about that all way, because it was pissing down rain.
Yeah,
and they made that little all way look like a footy field.
Yeah,
there was about 100 kids there.
Down upstairs,
and then we go to the game, and they're playing through that mud and everything. They played in the mud all day. Then they come home and they play footy all night like it was.
What was the feeling when Latrell Mitchell makes a decision at the last minute to play in the side. That must have been pretty exciting, pretty pumping for
everyone.
Everyone. The kids would have loved it.
The mood just went through the roof.
Well, like 200 of us like, there.
Because it was cool that he was our water boy.
Yeah.
We honestly, it was the coolest thing that we had him for the water boy. And then when he said that, when he, like, what'd you say, Brielle? Can you duck home and get my boots?
Yeah. And my mouth guard.
I think I'm going to drive the car guard up there to get him.
Yeah, yeah, we're looking myself around for drivers. Who's going to drive?
Nah, she needed him, I needed my mouth guard, otherwise I wouldn't have played anyways.
Oh, yeah, that's what. Yeah, I remember that. You gotta,
and I left it at, left it somewhere deliberately just to, you know. But anyway, I ended up getting it. And then
Matt
was, he was into me going, oh, it's going to be my last year. And you know how he goes on.
Oh, yeah.
I was actually filthy too because I hadn't turned up like ready to have a run, and it was a chance to have a run with Trell. So I was filthy at myself and not being ready to enjoy the moment more on the field, but just the weekend around was cool.
All the boys are mad. Like, you know, I just got to connect really well with them, and then now we go out to Wildcat and that, and you got Hunting Unlimited now, Unlimited Hunting now. So,
we just try to make you come in and not treat you like the star and fuss and just let you blend in and have a good time, you know.
Did that well. It was really good. I felt everyone was
you gotta make loving, so. Make you come back again, see?
And one of the great things that happened from that, young Brenton Byra played outside of him, he got an opportunity with the Dolphins off the back of his great performance there.
They played really well. Played that really was mad, good. Actually,
they got
him
to see how fast he was, eh?
Go from there. Boy, eh? Well, it's easy to give him a little flick there later, you know.
I reckon they
flies off the boys. You know?
Put some good moments.
Have you done anything like
you
that lately?
You run the length there too.
Oh,
you run the length. Fast. Set
that was
me
a
up
mad try.
Yeah, and you played Cody down there. And
yeah, first game.
Everyone was
all he said was, you stay over there, I'll stay on this. He's like, yeah, done. I said, all right, look after you. So I stayed on the left, he stayed on his left, we left it there. And
everyone was talking about it because I obviously was up in Sydney getting ready for the NRL Grand Finals, and everyone was talking about it, but you couldn't watch it. It was the biggest disappointment ever to know that this fellow was going up against Cody, and everyone was talking about it because it was going to be a great game anyway.
It was a great game.
And
it was really
all that excited about it, but they couldn't move it, and I'm going to be filthy on them organisers for a long time. They never moved it to the main field for the TV. I couldn't get over it.
Yeah, no, we were on the second field. And then, mate, everyone, there was no one watching over on the main field. It was always, like, everyone,
they could have just turned that camera around literally on the tower, you know, because we're only on the other side.
There's something. Around. I couldn't believe that we missed that moment. But what was that like going up against?
No, it was funny. I was actually, when he said that, like, I said, stay, and I said, I knew exactly what he meant. I said, don't run at me, pretty much. So so I left him alone there, and then but you know, you get the let on, and then it was just tricky to watch, you know, obviously playing against each other. Start of
well, they scored the first try too.
Yeah, that I was windy too. I was going, oh, here we go.
They were good.
They're and a good then, side, a great side.
A little fast follow on the what's his name? Adam Fitz.
Oh, Craig.
Fitz.
Alan Fitz.
Alan. That's it. Yeah.
Al Fitzgibbon.
He's quick killing it at the North at the moment too. He's been really good.
Having them fellas go up against little Dane Laurie and
they just had like a lot of natural, talented fellas. Yeah, out wide.
Little mad footy players. So you're like, oh, you know. And then once we got into them, it was sort of like, yeah, all right, we're rolling them down. But yeah, it's funny watching Cody just playing against him and just had a laugh. That's all you could do.
Just
laugh,
make a day, really.
Yeah, made my day. So
it's good. Cool. It's good and bad when you get to draw a team like that, eh? Because you want to see them go well, but then same time when you're up against them, it's a bit of fun to try and give him a little something.
Good thing about Cody though, he just moves on and starts supporting you. You know, he gets behind you.
Well, then
he's in the shed there with you.
Anyway, you know,
so. You know, and he still goes back and plays with his team. You won't give up. And
100%.
Same as what yous will do.
Going back a couple of years now, that I remember that game against Redfern, and it was old Craigie who used the line about – it was a great line he used about the kid man handling men when he come, because you were still a teenager then playing for –
19
playing for Taree, and you're a young fella, and you had a young team. I think you took Kyra and Bernie.
Nah, that was year after that.
The year after.
Before, and I think – yeah, and I didn't have them till –
yeah, you was a main man in that side as a kid. Yeah. And I just remember you virtually took on the old Redfern side there and took Taree a long way. And it was good to see Taree do well
top
again, because it was sort of like re-establishing that South Taree side, because I don't know if they've been in a lot.
No, I don't. I've never been in the final, I'm pretty sure. So Dad was telling me, like, it's probably one of the 20 years we were in it. So
they would play every year and they'd win a game.
Yeah,
and second game they'd fall off a bit, but – you know, they always had the talent. It was just a lot of the commitment, like a lot of our little teams, our little town teams, and plenty of commitment, but plenty of talent, sorry, but the commitment just needs to, you know, be a bit applied a bit better.
So. Nah, we'll be getting better, man. Obviously, there's two teams now, which you sort of see.
That the Waramai side too.
Crop coming through, and yeah, it's pretty good to see. Obviously, I've watched a lot of young fellas develop over the years, and yeah, we've actually got a good little crack inside at the moment, so. Hopefully, you know, we get them trained all year and get to then and we can pick a good side. And
one of the funniest, the freakiest moments from that game, that Redfern game that you're talking about, Dana.
Here we go.
The tackle.
Come on, Reek.
The tackle, that was a...
Sorry, brother, right now for in advance.
But, I mean, it had a build-up to
it. It was
a knockout moment.
Yeah. You took a few hits in the chin. You took
the boys understood that.
Yeah, here and there. And
I knew the camera was on Tuesday. Obviously, front of punch doesn't look... It's going to make me look worse. So I thought,
That tackle...
Made me look good by not punching back. Then, end of it, I'd do something. So,
well, yeah. You're young and like confident. Not cocky, confident.
It was unbelievable. Like a big power bomb, like a wrestling move.
You have to give him some credit.
Wrestler.
It's the fourth game.
But the funny thing was there was no one really like of that size or physicality that could come in and put him in his place. The boys all run in and Latrell just had these long arms pushing them all away. And
it was,
this kid's just, as a 18-year-old kid out there just standing over everyone, but no one could pull him in the line because the boys weren't probably physically
even if you wanted to, after seeing what he did, I'd be like... just don't do it.
We'll get you next time, nephew. next time. You have more respect.
But all our fellas are good too. All our cowboys and that, and yeah, they were really good with it. So
there's one fella's going to get away with it. It's Trell. Like they're not going to tell you what to do out there. Size here.
Not after seeing that. I don't want to get power. Wasn't as well.
But I don't think it was the last time he sort of done it either. I might have saw a little bit of it last week there on TV. He picked someone up there and just politely let him down.
You got that aggression.
When I was talking about your dad,
that's what your dad, he had that bit of killer in him, you know. He was a competitor.
I love that.
He'd come in and he'd hit you hard and he'd take you on and he wanted to beat you so badly. I just remember getting on the field going, Matty, you were a good fella, bro. I'm like, you're trying to kill me. You're chasing me everywhere and you got that aggressive talk. And then as soon as the game finished, you're nice as fella again back to you. And like, sit there and have a yarn and laugh. But
there's been a few like that over the years.
Very competitive. Wilfred Williams got that about him. He got that bit of killer when he's on the field. And
Wilfred Williams had some killer about him on the field.
Oh, God. Wilfred got some killer on him off the field too.
Wilfred used to say before the game, he'd say, I don't want no one coming in my team if they've got no in them. If they haven't got any cut in them, I'm not playing with them. And as soon as that bloke would go out there, and if he got lifted first run, get him off. And then Dad's like, we're picking this team. Like we just say, Wilfred played with Wilgood and Rindrid over the years ago. We're picking this team, Wilfred. And he goes, give me a look at that team sheet. And he'd look at it and he goes, nah, he's not got no cut in him. He's got to go.
He was the enforcer that way, Wilfred. He's like that.
We weren't anyone to tell him what to do. He won knockouts.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that's what you got to have. Trell's like that. He doesn't want anyone in his side to pull through in a
knockout. You got to have players like that too.
Yeah,
even in footy, like that's a real strong attribute that not everybody has to be able to get in and mix it up like that.
Yeah, it gives everyone confidence, I reckon. So.
And it changes the game.
100%. If someone's doing that for me, I can do that back for them. It just creates, you know, this energy that, you know.
I'd have to say growing up in Bathurst and playing with our Wilgood sides, we didn't have any of those real tough fellas left. Like Buddy was our last one. Next one was probably Trent and Matt. And George used to just outrun everyone. He'd just go all day. But it was hard to have those. What is he? A blue cattle dog? No, but George just said, he had the engine and he was big, so he didn't have to kill you. He'd just kill you in those hit-ups. But, yeah, going back to just not having that mongrel bred a fellow like a Wilfred out there, we used to always – it was a highlight to us because we never had one. But
And you're talking about Taree footballers. One of my favourite was a fellow called Dave Simon. Dave come up and played with us at Nau, and he got in with a girl from Armidale, and he moved up to Armidale, and tough front rower – Redhead fella, but tough and would go all day, Dave. And for us up there in Armidale, he's still one of our favourite players to play for now. Come from out of town, but once he put on that Narwin jersey, play in. And I don't know if the old man's told you about Dave when Dave was playing, but geez, he was one of a good, tough footballer from Taree, Dave Simon. I have to mention him, you know, he's one of my favourite knockout players to play with.
You remember any knockout, any Taree fellas, Tom?
Well, I had a few play with us in the Black Trackers over the years. And they were Simon's, all Simon's at all blood, you know. And those fellas are just tough, confident, had the mongrel. They didn't care who they played against. You'd say, you know, we're going against the Yowies, yeah. Send them in, and they just go out and smash them. But, you know, they need another 10 of them to go with them. So we'd run out of puff because we didn't have enough to back them up. But they're good footballers out there. I won't mention any names. They all get jealous of each other. But I had about 6 or 7 Tari Foster boys with me. So, yeah, they're good footballers.
What have you enjoyed the most about playing in the knockout the last few years?
I think just for me, obviously, I'm obviously full on with footy and, you know, it just takes up my life. And I suppose sometimes you can lose the joy of having it as work and then obviously the game. And, you know, you got to love it because, I still do it. So I still love it. But going back to them, like knockouts when they come every year, it's just like, I know it's given back to, the people because they see you every week on TV. But then I just have them in that one spot, that one time, wherever it is. It's, it's just, I'm great, like grateful just to be there and play and just give back. And I know the kids love it and all our people love it. So I know I always go and see the elders when I get there and, they love that part of it as well. So, just getting back, giving back. That's what I love about
it. We have had many players that have won a World Cup a month later after playing in a knockout. Like, has there been many of them? Who's done that before?
No, I don't think many have. Yeah. I think Rick was training with the Kangaroos and that there and those tools and all that sort of thing after the knockouts and he just missed a selection. That's probably his.
I can't think of many that are about to play for Australia and they still.
I know there's a lot that have pulled out at the last minute because they've got named in the.
What about the Prime Minister's one, Nathan Merritt? I'm bringing that one up. Nathan,
I think he'd be one of like when I was just in when he was talking and saying, getting ready to win a World Cup, and obviously we watched that World Cup and how good you've played over there and win the World Cup.
And you killed
it. But a month before that, you're playing at the knockout. Like, is there any sport in the world where a person will be winning a World Cup a month after just playing against local fellas who are just throwing on a jersey? Well, like, it just doesn't happen in sport, does it?
How many people would choose to play in a knockout to do before
no
that?
No one would.
Nah, I think a lot of people get scared of it. But I just go, I'm confident. Like, talk about confident and going in. If you're not confident, you go in and, you get lifted. So you go in and have a crack. And
I think someone over here was getting close to getting picked for Australia over here. He was playing in a knockout
Tom
one year.
Making up them yarns again. No,
I love my brother. I love my brother. And he's shy about all this stuff. But, there's some things we know.
But it would never happen in any other sport in the world where a person wins a world championship, wins a World Cup, but a month before it they're playing with just a local fellow down in a local team and playing for
He went and played front row for the Kangaroos. He had the big number 8 on.
Under 8, number 8.
Stink them numbers.
Yeah, that was bad.
I don't even know why they did that.
I reckon the beauty of the experience of the knockout, again, that's it, is that best centre in the world won a World Cup just weeks later, best centre in the world. And before that, people got the opportunity to play alongside him or against him.
Yeah.
And it was one of the coolest experiences that people could have in their life. You know, you're never going to get the chance to say that again. And that's why
they'll be all mad. I'm telling their kids, I carved Latrell Mitchell.
Yeah. A few people tackled you. I know they're still bragging about how they tackled you.
Yeah, I love it. That's good. Give them something to talk about.
Yeah.
That's what it's about.
Now, we just had to take a quick moment. Tommy Tucker forgot what time his flight was, and so he's exited the conversation and Trent Rose has entered the conversation. I've been trying to get this fella on this podcast for how long we've been going, 12 weeks or something? Refused every time. Took Latrell Mitchell to who you got to be? You got to be Latrell Mitchell to get this fella on the podcast.
Something like that.
My big brother, that's it.
What's your favourite Latrell Mitchell moment at the knockout, bros? You've seen him play a few with you and then obviously other teams?
No, I think everyone talks about it. It's that little Redfern moment. I love it. just watching him hammer throw poor little Reeves, but it's plenty of mad moments with us too, I must say. It was very special. I still think he looks unreal in all red and it suited him.
Colour.
suited him to a T, but some of them mad runaway try actually. I forget who it was against.
Yeah,
but just spreading out.
No, it was against Burke.
Big
fella in the centre there. Yeah, he was giving it to me all game, swearing at me and all.
Yeah,
and I was just like, I don't know. You keep talking.
And big fella just legged that just mad long field try. I was just
I remember watching that one.
Yeah,
but what about your time with the Yowies there? You played with the Yowies last year.
Yeah,
tell us a bit about that.
Obviously, Walk and Amy, a bit of connection there, and countries come together up near Biripi there and Anawan. So, you know, I just think, yeah, just having a crack with them was fun. And like I said, I got the chance of, you know, obviously with No Limit Boys and the Black Money Boys. So, you know.
How many games did you play last year?
Only two, three.
So three, eh?
Moree pushes, eh? That was a good game.
Yeah, they pushed. That was fun.
What was that Moree game like?
Tell us about that one.
That was hard. They rough, eh? Like, obviously, big Toby Keys and you had Mundar and, you know, he was stressing. Right? It was mate, he didn't know where we were going to punch in the mouth or get me a handshake. So I said, just shake my hand. Come on now. At the end of the game.
But no, but I reckon that's every time you speak to Munz too. Yeah, he's got that wild look about him. You don't know.
Lift girl, you know, kiss her. So, nah, but he, it was good. I really enjoyed that. Obviously, they gave us a bit of a touch up at start and then come home strong. And I threw a ball at the centre and we ended up scoring there. So, that was enjoyable. Obviously, went down to young Dream Bullers team there, the North Coast.
Yeah, a tweet connection. Mad little time.
That was mad. So, they had a really good team, but it was just like, it was just stop, start, you know, because someone would get knocked out and someone had eyed or, you know, so, you know, we ended up going through that game and then, yeah, just like I said, by the end of it, I got sent off with 10 and or 5. And,
what did you get sent off for?
Oh, you reckon it's ADMI, but it wasn't even me. So.
Now, tell me about this controversial try against Moree. Now, you said you threw the ball. Was it a try?
Is this the controversial one?
I wasn't there, but I've heard all about this.
Yeah, I don't know where they're going with it, but it wasn't.
It was a try, it was hands a
nice,
down.
Nice ball, straight to the. Oh, no, back row went through, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, right.
Anyway, just, yeah, he ran the score, so I was good.
It's a try.
I hope so, Moree. I know they're doing really well.
I was right in front of him. That's probably why the yarn
in the corner.
I
was
right in front of him.
Trying to make the call. Legit try or what?
Legit try, but it was awkward because. Obviously, we got that Gomery connection to Moree, you know, and Munz and that. So we wanted them to do good. But then we got that connection with Wok and the Yowies and all that. So it was one of them games where you didn't want to cheer too loud for one team because, well, I was staying with all the Moree crew, you know. So I was in that little corner.
He was cheering against you.
I'll admit it. When the boys went over, I was like, oh, and then sort of just went down little shell again.
And that was a try. So fair and square we won. We had to come back from behind too. So
right at the end of the game, eh?
That's set to. We ended up winning, so it was good.
Another one of them mad games we didn't get to watch on
TV.
Exactly, another one. I think I was commentating someone's second side versus a rake-up side while this game was going on another field. I was just like, can't we just move them games?
On them fields over the buck, hey?
Move them games onto this main field. Like, that's the football that everyone wants to see, you know. That's the Dane Gagai was in the Moree team. So you imagine that for the people who don't know much about knockout and then the Latrell Mitchell's about to go up against Dane Gagai plus all the other different players, Tyrell Sloan.
I forgot Dane played, eh?
Yeah,
Moree. Yeah, there you go.
And them exciting young Moree players, you know, that everyone wants to see. We need to see him on the main field. It's tragic not to be able to see it.
No, we'll make sure it doesn't happen again.
It was the organisers, you know, who won it last year? NAB.
We won it.
Wolgat. Yeah.
Whack won it.
I'm saying about Whack, Newcastle.
I thought talking about who won it.
You get the last say, you know.
You've
got to make sure.
Hopefully, Whack can move them big games onto the.
Or at least film it in some way. There will be times where two good games come up against each other.
Can't always make the decision.
But again, you got to be there to see it too. That's why you got to be there to experience it, have that moment, that feeling of rushing across to another field because all the whispers start coming back. There's a mad game over there, Moree and Yowie's are playing over.
I think that's what's probably the best thing about it, because then you look around.
And then you try to rush around, everyone's
moving. Because
you're warming
up and then you don't know. And then once you get there and you kick off, it's just packed. Like Moree follows everyone.
Weren't Cody and that playing around that same time as well on that field too? There was somebody else on field two, I remember, because I was sort of half stuck in between, but then I was just like, because
weren't we warming up while they played?
No, we'd finished just before their game, because I went there straight after, I think we just beat that Swan Memorial, I believe, and then I think Cody and that played after us, but it was at the same time as them, and again, it was games on field two and three that potentially could have been on that main one, but...
They're red hot games. Talking about some of the teams, and it's going to happen this year where you're going to have great sides going up against each other early, and you want to see all that footy. It's special, you know. There's some great games there to watch.
I do love that feeling though when someone comes across and tells you there's a mad game going on. Yeah, look around. Yeah, let's go and do it. How long we got? Let's go and do it.
Catch the end of it.
Catch the end of it. See a little stink or something.
Yeah.
Who's you've been up against a few mad little players. Who's some people that you've either enjoyed playing alongside or enjoyed playing against over the years of the knockout?
Oh, gee.
Testing you out, yeah.
Thinking right back, you know?
Testing you out.
No, I think Brenton was a pretty good one. Like, just obviously see him develop and just have, you know, didn't realise how fast it was until you actually got him in open space, man, and then got out a big mullet up the back flying.
He's
there,
fast.
He stole a couple of tries off me there, but I won't hold him against him, so. Hold him against him, so. But he was one, and Benny was also, like, just watching him obviously as a young kid was mad, so. And got to play with him and obviously, you know, having a pretty big role in, you know, trying to win some games with him, and he's always, you know, he was leaning on me a lot with it, and then by the end of it, I was leaning on him because my groin started going in that last game. But playing with him, obviously being one of my idols growing up, so it was mad. And then, yeah, playing with yourself, like I said, there's a lot of fellas, you know, I'll enjoy watching, and you know, like playing with little young Sloaney was good, and just all them boys, you know, that, you know, you get to see come through the NRL system, and hopefully, you know, Dream Buller was mad. Like I said, I'm rattling all off the NRL players, but it's just good to be able to, you know, play against them fellas in a, like a sort of a non-biased settings in a way where, or really, you
it's
know.
Cool that we talk about like the vibe that everyone gets, the buzz that everyone gets off getting to play against or alongside Trell, and he's talking about, you know, getting the opportunity to play against someone like Benny Barber. Like how cool was that, you two coming together? Because two of the most exciting Aboriginal footballers that we've seen in the NRL over the last few decades.
Yeah.
What was it like coming in and playing alongside him?
No, like I said, man, I was just like watching him as a young fella, and then you know, all I ever wanted to do was be like these fellas that are before me, and now you know I'm doing it. But at the same time, I get to play, you know, this game with him, and I was just buzzing. And I think that was one of the, you know, obviously playing with you boys, and then you know that was one of the things that sort of persuaded me too, because I was like, oh, Benny Barber, you know, like, man, this is gonna be mad. And we actually had a, like I said, I enjoyed it.
Is that a mad connection?
Yeah, it was mad. We just played footy, bro, and there was some flick pass he'd throw out of his ass, I'd be there, and if I do the same thing. And he'd catch it, and then we'd just score mad try kick, and like just it was mad. We didn't even have to talk. It's like me and Cody have, you know.
Yeah.
And that's what I felt with Benny. And I was like, man, I wish this fella still had another couple of years in him. So.
Oh.
You know. So, but.
Don't we all? Mate. Don't we all?
Yeah, but no, that was really enjoyable. And like I said, there's a lot of great people and a lot of great players out there. And yeah, I know a couple of fellas were trying to bang me, and they were getting, you know, their little highlights out of that. So I have to giggle at that because it's, you know, it's special because that's memories forever, you know. So,
yeah. An opportunity get to tackle Latrell Mitchell. I hope that we play you so I get a chance to tackle you.
No, I'm not running.
You're going to catch him, are you?
I won't be up. No, I'll be third man in.
I'm coming for the ribs.
It was like Jareem Buller last year. He had a run. Someone got hold of him and I come in and dived in on him. I was like, yeah, I tackled Jareem.
What about Shaq? Growing up with Shaq and playing alongside him now and seeing what he's done with his career?
Well, he is one of the fellas that got me into rugby league. Me and him sort of, you know, obviously went through our journey together at a time there when we got to 20s and, you know, all the way up, I played up with Shaq because I just played with my little age and it was just, I wasn't learning nothing. So Dad put me up with Shaq and yeah, I learned a lot playing with him and developing with other players. And obviously being younger, you know, I grew a lot quicker because I had to learn more and obviously toughen up a bit quicker than, you know, most. And
and
then obviously having Shaq, you know, have a stink with you every weekend or every night we play footy in the backyard, you know. So we always had this mad big paddock next to us, right next to our house. And we'd always, be your Shaq, me, always a different opposite team. All the cousins come over and go for one for one. And you always have your mad little crew, you know, you always pick your cousins. And
did you used to go on opposite teams?
Yeah, every time, never play together.
So that's a mad little spot there that you've got just near the house, eh?
Yeah.
So
we always had this little, a little crack and, you know, there'd always be punch-ups or something. Shaq, run it straight, run it straight.
Run it straight.
What big boy, because I got to, you know, because you can't catch me, I run straight at you. Yeah, that's why I was quick, so I had to get around him. And I'm telling you, we had some punch-ons in the half, and I always had my little brother on my side too, so he'd be cheeky, my older brother, so then I had to get in the middle and get, you know, get my teeth punched in, you know. So just went around in circles. But, you know, I had, like I said, developed quick because I was playing with Shaq and then watching him progress and grow into this superstar. And yeah, that's what he was in the mid-North Coast with Shaq. It was just a yarn about Shaq Mitchell, you know, coming through. And
he's a freak, eh?
Yeah, 6'1" at, you know, 12 years, 13 years of age. And, you know, and I'm just here, this little short fella, then he just grows to a little 16, you know. So, but, yeah, just playing with him was, you know, unbelievable. And I got to, you know, start in our rep honours and go to 20s with the Roosters. And SG Ball, we ended up winning the comp there. So, but then, you know, gradually he fell off a little bit there and, you know, had his little battle and he'll talk about it openly. And but yeah, look, he's is really, I'm really proud of him, the way he's been able to do it. And I think he's one of those in a real, you know, good story, feel good story. So, you know, if anyone's to get an example of, you know, adversity and being shown that and then obviously coming out the other side, it's, yeah, Shaq Mitchell. So I'm very proud of him. And, yeah, I get to play with him at the South Sydney Rabbitohs now. And a team that we've always grown up, you know, obviously having as our second team, but, you know, Dad was always, you know, one
Tyree red. Tyree colours.
One red, one green eye, and Tyree, yeah. South Tyree colours. And that Rabbitohs just all Tyree, eh? Like, everyone just loved. But when we went to the Roosters, they were torn. So, like, half went over and half went over. Then when we moved back, they're like, oh, they've got to move back again, you know? So, but, yeah, nah, just having Shaq there at a train and watching him, you know, progress into an NRL player now. And, yeah, like, I've done it for a few years now and, yeah, it's just good to see them.
Because when you first come down to Sydney too, you were doing a lot of travel, eh? Were you travelling from out west?
Yeah, well, lived in here first and then moved out there because Shaq had his woman there. And so he's like, nah, you got to come with me and live with me out at Arnie's here. So we were out at Seven Hills for a while. And yeah, sure traveling enough, I get my license first and yeah. Shaq still didn't get his license till about now, I reckon. He's nearly 30. But, you know, I had to drive the big fella in all the time and, but then I started gradually going to NRL training as a 17-year-old kid and I had to do a bit of a receptionist job and started going early and then I was doing a bit of painting in the shed and, you know, just selling off like that and just like little stuff like that and just makes you really, really humble about, you know, where you come from. And obviously I've had a pretty rough upbringing and the journey I was on was never really, you know, a straight and narrow one. It was always a rocky one, but it made me learn on the way. And like now it's a roller coaster, you know, you obviously see what I go through and, you know, you've always been there as my support network. And, yeah, it's just good to be able to come out the other side and be humble about, you know, where you come from. And but then having Shaq, like I said, that journey just come full circle.
That's cool, man.
Yeah, for me it's awesome because we started, you know, together. We wasn't allowed to play footy and then come up home one day and said, Dad, we're signing up. Because, you know, he's obviously been through all the Mum took us, signed us up. So she said, right, then, because, you know, we got a good background of tennis and all that, you know, so on my mum's side. So, yeah, we just – that's all my dad always thought about was, yeah, they have options, you know. You always want your kids to be the opposite of tennis player, right? Eh? Yeah, I go, I'm good at ping pong, I've flogged everyone in here, so.
Latrell Federer.
But no. Serve on him.
Yeah, just being, you know, looking back and reminiscing on those things. I know one day when I retire, you know, and lace the boots up, but those are the things I look forward to and look back on, and yeah.
How driven are you, brother, win this knockout for Tyree, South Tyree?
Yeah, I'm excited. Like I said, if we get a good little forward pack there, I know we can do a good job. So that's all I need at the moment. So
you've seen the boys, what they build at Walgett, you know. Yeah, and Walgett's a small town. Yeah, sometimes you got to find your way to make it successful, 100%. You know what I mean? So
yeah, nah, I'm not going to look too far out. But like I said, if key boys are keen, I'm keen. But if not, I'll just make do like I did back then, you know, in 17 and like we've always done. So, and you know, his Facebook status is raking up teams week. Yeah, we'll do it. Probably be that way soon. Nah. But
because you'd have a lot of good mates there that would want to come and play with you.
No, I do. Yeah, for sure.
A lot of boys have put their hand up.
That's only a phone call, man. Like I said,
yeah. Shaq's got a lot of good connections.
Yeah, Shaq. Yeah, said just a couple of frontiers and we'd be right. All my big cousins are keen to come back and play. You know, they're always working or flat out or something going on. So
get them training, bro.
Yeah, I got them.
12 weeks.
Got them working. I got them working. So
they're working the farm.
Yeah, then come lift some cattle up on their shoulders.
Yeah, you get everyone fencing. That's the one, eh?
Almost had
the hardest job.
Almost had South Sydney doing it for me, bro. But all the labour would have been free. But Big Tommy got COVID and then just ruined it.
Oh, when you were doing the camp up there.
Yeah, so us leadership group had to carry just these three logs from all the way back at Taree Mission, Perth Lake Mission, all the way into town, across the Manning Bridge, down to my farm. And just ruined me, ruined my shoulders. All the boys are crook. And then end up, you know, the camp ended up being nothing by the end of it. So we had a good leadership, you know, started the camp to doing that, to building this camp up. And then I was getting ready to put the boys to mad work and sure enough.
So, bro, this is how I know he's a genius because he had all his fencing that he had to do on his farm, a whole lot of fencing. And what he did was he went to South and said, why don't we do a tough army camp style training up on my farm? We'll get them doing all these fences, carrying all these
digging holes.
He was getting his fences done. That's what he was thinking.
I had it all planned out. But then, Tom mucked it up for me, so... Yeah, no, I had to do it all myself. Dad drive a tractor and sit in there while I had to carry all the big, you know, split posts and run wire. And, mate, we only just got it done now and it's been 2 years, 3 years.
What's the hardest gig on the farm? What's the hardest
thing? Yeah, I think a fencing would have to be one of those hardest things ever, you know. And then I feel for the fellas that have hilly country because I've got a big block up in the mountains there near Nowndock. So, just, oh, mate, the fellas that go fencing up that way is an unbelievable job. Like, just clearing to get in the wire. Oh, man. Like, so that's probably one of the hardest. And you know, the rest is, you know, just looking after the cows is pretty much either like big dogs, just yeah, like yeah. grass.
You got some good ones out there too. I went up there at Christmas time and went out and yeah. visited the boys there on the farm.
I'm selling my big bull too. So any of you farmers listening, let me know.
Did you get any meat off him, Dino?
No, he knocks some good calves in Big Speckle Park, all black. So
we're looking.
He needs to go now. He's been busting my fences, so he needs to, yeah.
He got some big bulls there though, hey?
Yeah, by temperament, mad, eh? See, you sit there and pat him and kick back.
I'm still waiting for some steak from you.
Yeah, with my
Sent
beef.
Me plenty of pigs.
It's coming soon. It's coming soon.
I've been waiting a good 12 months for that.
Wagyu, you reckon?
Yeah.
So South Taree. This year. South Taree.
Well, we went to Biripi Sharks there for a bit. Yeah. Mm. And then I said, we had to go back. I said, we got to go back, you know, to the OG. So, you know.
Now, we had Peter Jensen on here a few episodes back, and he said the one thing that everybody goes to a team for is a gear. I wasn't thinking it was gear at the time, but that's what he said, it was a gear. What do he's got? He's going South Sydney
style.
Yeah,
we'll go back to, you know, red and green. So, yeah, be good.
And what about the team? How he's looking?
Looking all right. I think, like I said, just getting, I reckon there's a good couple of fronties there. Got Big Shaq, caught me a little above the line, get him fit, he'll be ready. So.
What position does Lionel play?
Oh, he's like a lock sort of style, but he's a big man too, so.
He's a big man.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's all big men.
So I reckon he's a big fronty. He'll play fronty, him and Shaq up front.
They got size, eh? That's the thing about black fellas, right? If they got that size, eh? Doesn't matter if they got all the ability in the world, you're playing front row. Yeah. Like,
oh, mate.
They're very, very hard to come by.
But I reckon we look pretty good. So we got a little, you know, obviously, I think Ethan Ferguson was with South here, young fellow.
Oh, yeah.
So hopefully we can try and rake him up. He's on a wing or a centre. And
he's a big winger too.
He's a big tall fellow, yeah. And they got a few fellows, like all good young kids, look good crop. So, you know, just get a good team together and I think we'll have a good dig at it. But, yeah, I'm pretty excited. Like I said, give back and I've always sponsored South Taree up until now and get back into it. And, well, you know, maybe one day South Taree will put Winmurra team in, you know.
Mad.
You know, I just thought, that, you know, who knows.
Kyle Mundine, one fella from – been up there and played a bit of footy at Taree. He a good knockout player, Kyle. I don't know where he is now, but he's one of my favourite Taree players at one stage. He's unbelievable footwork and strength. And
was that he played for RAB too?
Yeah, he played with RAB and won knockouts with him at RAB.
Well, I remember him, he was playing up in Taree City Bulls there and Old Bar, and, you know, he's come in between them two teams. So, but him playing he was always the gun centre. Or, you know,
good footballer, man.
Follows fast. You know,
really good footballer.
Yeah, he was awesome to watch. I remember coming through 16, 17, I played my first little, game for 18s there for the Bulls and just watching him at first grade was mad, but Dad would never let me play, he said. So he wouldn't let me play first grade. But, it was good to see him obviously come through. But, like I said, if we rake up a good team, we can have a good rattle at it. So you never know and knock it.
He's built something good up there. I know, talking to your dad there on the weekend and just he pretty determined to get it going and get it run properly. And you'd obviously, you play with the Wolga at the Owies, you play with some good sides.
So I know what I want the camps to look like and obviously how we got to, you know, you got to be professional these days, let's be honest. Like, you've got to have good sleep,
100%.
Wake up every morning and good feed and make sure everyone's fed. So he's run it the best, I reckon, and the Owies. So.
I'll tell you what, when you're a young fella, one of the hardest things about the knockout is not going to the after party. That's one of the hardest things.
It's a hard thing as an old fella too. It's not just a young fella thing. I still had the same problem last year.
It's the best night out though. The most amazing night out. It's hard to say no to an after party.
I don't think I ever have said no. That's my problem, I think, at the knockout.
It is hard. And that's one of the hard things. The professionalism is not going out and, you know, the rest of it. But it's also it also joins into part of the weekend. So.
It's changed a lot in the days because for black fellas, it's like Christmas, right? Like you're going to see everyone. You get to catch up with everyone in a real positive space. We all go out. We share laughs. We got yarns to tell from the last 12 months what we've all been doing. It's the best night ever, you know what I mean? But you have seen the professionalism change, teams now, it's they're about the football. Yeah. They're about the preparation.
The winning, just like that last game they want to win.
And makes a difference. The preparation makes a difference in it. So you can't do it.
That's the thing. I mean, there's always some plenty of good stories come from after parties too, you know, like as
dance-off. Didn't you win a dance-off on you?
I think I come second. It was a dance. Went to the final dance. Off, yeah, and I think he did the caterpillar and beat me. Might have been Owen Craigie.
Old services club up there at Armidale.
Yeah, shoulder wouldn't let you down like that, eh, bro? You tried to
a couple of injuries from the game. My moonwalk didn't come out.
That was the 1% of difference.
That knee was blowing up a little bit there.
But I was the same as it was on the field and on the after party. I was going to try the hardest, you know. I was going to give it all the effort, you know. Best effort goes to Dino. So
now, one of the things that we've been talking about potentially change. One of the rules we've been talking about changing is the golden point. So at the moment it's first try wins in the if it's a draw at the end of time. But we're talking about having golden point for 5 minutes on the back end from
the start, from day one?
Yeah, from day one. Golden point. If no try or anything scored in that time.
Do you have to wait till that 5 minutes has run out or the first point?
No, first point, game point. Over.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts on golden point?
I reckon
it's good
because obviously a lot of arguments that go into, you know, just having first try. And, yeah, I think it'd be good and gives you a bit more excitement as well, you know. So, but, yeah, I reckon it's up to you followers really. I don't mind. I'll kick a field goal from anywhere.
Yeah. No, you probably could. It would play straight into your ear.
Mr. Melvin Storm.
But I reckon I agree with you. It's that excitement factor that comes with it. No, I reckon that's the best thing about blackfella footy. It's so exciting.
I reckon because then it just becomes that, you know, free-flowing game. By the end of it, you want to win. So everyone just, you know, you're throwing the ball around and then a field goal comes into play as well. So, you know, obviously some arguments
What's the furthest you kicked a field goal from?
In a game?
Either.
Oh, out of a game, probably 60, I reckon.
Far out.
At training, 60s. And then, you know, at a game, obviously, against Melbourne Storm there.
Wallop. Nailed
that's
that
mad,
one.
That one. Yeah, that's one of my favourites.
Oh, yeah. The one, from the actually, corner. You know what? The one with South was probably further, I reckon, than the one with Roosters. I did it both in Melbourne. But one was going point win the game, one was a tie. So,
that's mad.
Because my goal kicking was shocking that day, so.
That Melbourne one was special, though.
Yeah.
The way that all happened.
And
the Roosters one.
Actually, we were down there the other day for Origin and we trained on Amy Park. It just come back to me. It was mad. And then obviously Frank Panisi's Melbourne Storm follow there. So, and he was manager for us for New South Wales. That's all he could talk about, eh? And it was just, he's looked straight at me too. He's like, he come over and look straight at me too. I said, no, I wasn't. I was looking at Craig.
That's good.
While we got him in, I want to touch on it with you two too. Jack Whiten in the knockout last year.
Oh, I've got him.
But tell us about him. Tell us about Jack because I know everyone out there, like for him to play in that knockout last year, I thought he was outstanding too and he's built for knockout football, Jack. But what was he like, Georgie? Latrell,
I wanted to win one more game to go up against him. It would have been mad.
So. Yeah, it would have been good. Yeah. It would have been
Jeez, that would have been
but
a good battle.
You know what was funny, right? So Jack, he's probably one of the strongest people I've ever met.
100%.
Like biggest, strongest, can hit, can run. He's got every attribute. Yeah. You go through that attribute, he's got absolutely everything. But he was nervous about coming into the knockout because he wasn't sure, you know, like.
He's overthinking about
it. Yeah, he overthinks too much. How hard do I go? What do I do? That sort of thing.
And then once he's in, he'd be sweet, but he'd go. Because then when we were in World Cup after that, when we were in World Cup, we played in that together. I'm not bringing it back to that, but he'd be like, Joe, you reckon we'll win? Like this every game,
He's so worried about.
Mad overthinker, you know. Yeah. So I could understand why he would have been the way he was.
And that was it. And then as soon as he had a run, he sort of.
And he was
I think
right,
his first run, he sort of took it half-assed and they lifted him. They hit him hard and they hit him on the way down and someone else flew in and then he was like, if I keep running like that, I'm going to get lifted. So then he switched on. Then he's like, nah, stuff this.
Yeah.
And I think the difference is too is he's talking about he wants to play with his younger brother this year. And if his younger brother is alongside him, I think that his level, he'd be at 100 straight away.
Yeah.
He'd be the protector and he would probably fold that many people that you know, it'd be unbelievable. But when he was going in there just alongside everyone else, that was his thing. He was overthinking it. But then
I think obviously he hasn't
athletically,
played,
he's
played
amazing,
for a while too. So just, athletically unbelievable. So, just having, his little rig he's got on there too. So he goes all right. Everything about him is just a superstar and I love playing with him and I'm glad he's here now and persuaded him to come up here and obviously started here didn't go the way we wanted it to, but now we're coming out this sort of the other side and he's seeing the wins and starting to feel that, the lifestyle that he's got here now. Yeah. It's cool, he's loving that part of it, and then of course now the footy's coming, he feels like he's on top of the world at the moment. So
tell me this, bro. Does it make you sick when he talks about how he feels unfit?
Mate, when he goes,
and he's got like this rippling eight-pack.
He said, I feel heavy, eh? Like, I feel, you know, I feel unfit. I'm sitting there going, mate, I've got head noise now because I'm going, what are you on about, bro? He said, look at this fella and he's got a shirt. He's going, oh, I feel heavy, like this and that. Like, I don't think I'm up.
I wouldn't wear shirts if I was Jack.
Nah. It was like at the start of preseason. Eh? He said, oh, I'm so unfit and I'm out of shape.
I'm not nervous.
He had an 8-pack. He won the 1.2K time trial or whatever.
Straight away.
Off his first day and he's saying, I'm unfit and I'm you know, overweight.
I'm like, this is ashamed of me.
Bro, I want to look like that unfit and overweight. This is what I look like when I'm good.
Yeah, me, bro.
So one year you had Latrell Mitchell playing for Wildwood, and the next year you got Jack White. And it must give confidence to everyone, eh?
I think it does. I think obviously the best thing about knockout is players like these fellas can play in a team, and we were blessed that we have the relationship that we do with Trell that extends beyond football and a lot more into the personal life, you know. So how we went with Trell to have him with us, it was very special. And I know we sort of touched on it, but when we were sitting around in that little circle and expressing everything and had the big fella there, like, I know we're all just pumped, raring to go. Just that he was going to run the water for us, you know what I mean, or have him in our camp. Mm. Like, we were just – everyone was over the moon, like, oh, we got Trell Mitchell in with us, you know. He wasn't even playing, but like he said, he kept that mouth guard in a special place and his boots in a special place because he knew them feet would be itching. And, you know, we get him 1 year and done an amazing job. And, you know, unfortunately we did come up short, but the experience that we got out of having Trell in our team, I think it goes both ways with, you know, when we spoke to him about what he learnt from our team and everybody in our family and to become part of our bigger family, of our WAC family and all that. And again, like I said, when he played this year, last year with the Owies, you know, he's still part of the WAC family. And
They fit in easy, eh, in the teams, don't they?
Cause
I know you, whatever, I've seen you at All Stars, you just, it reminds me just of, you know, your cousins all come together and you play, you have that same sort of natural thing at All Stars.
Yeah, no, that's lovely. I love when I go into there, bro. It's just easy because there's some young fellas that come in that don't know, they're too strong about who they are as a person, but they know where their people come from. And like then watching them sort of develop over that week and, you know, get proud and proud every day they wake up was, pretty special for me. And, you know, I grow up proud and, you know, I grew up, you know, in a small community, so I sort of understood how to be black and how to be, you know, proud. So, you know, just watching them and then they come back the next year prouder and prouder. So that's very special. And, you know, like I said, just going into them camps is unbelievable. And then obviously coming in and seeing what he's doing, how he's run knockout, that's what I want for Tari, you know. So that's something that'd be pretty special for them to be able to experience and, you know, have that family orientation.
So who's getting Jack White and Tari or Wild?
No, that's Matt's going, you can't take my players off me if you got it.
Brother-in-law, though.
Yeah, I forget. I said, yeah, come play with me, cuz. He's like,
surely Jack owes you a year there at Tari or something.
Owes me Jack.
Oh, I just named my son Jack. I just named my son Jack. Surely I get it.
That's old Poppy Jack, not after Jack White.
That's what I said. You better take after your pop, not after this.
We'll probably get another 10 years out of Jack and we'll let Trill have him then.
We've been hitting them with the old Johnny Farnham tricks. Matt was doing it there. Matt did it for about 10 years. Nah, this is my last year.
Could
you get some of the South boys with AJ? Because AJ hasn't played many knockouts, I don't think.
Nah, he'd be too windy, I reckon, old AJ.
Drag him along to Tari.
Yeah, I think he'd play with him. Whack.
No, hasn't he played with Lapa before?
He played Lapa,
he probably played one or two, yeah.
No, I don't know. We got their Tassers there, but he played with Whack too, so.
Young Talos.
He won't play this
young
year.
Young Talos played with Lapa.
But he's Lapa boy, so.
I think he'll have a good team, good draw.
Mm. Yeah.
Anything can happen.
I'm just keen to get Tari's all done up and see on paper and see where it's at and then go from there. If we need something, we need something. Yeah. We just have a crack.
No, I'm looking forward to seeing the gear too, the old Rabbitohs colours.
Yeah.
A lot of Rabbitohs fans will be loving that too, actually. That's one thing that I did notice too when you come and play with us is that we got a lot of support from Rabbitohs fans.
Yeah.
The fact that he was playing, you know, there was Rabbitohs people that had travelled down there to video with him.
It was heaps, hey?
Yeah.
Even Bunny's
TV. They actually got some mad angles.
I remember
there was some real good tries you scored.
Cameron Murray there, I'm sure. That Murray is a black fella name.
Yeah.
Brianna there, see my,
yeah. If I'm in North Coast.
My son's partner. I'm sure there's something somewhere connected. Oh, Cam Murray turn up and knock out be a good one to say.
He'd go good, actually.
Oh, unbelievable, Alan. I'm sure they got a connection. They got a connection, I'm sure, somewhere. They've been around the family.
No more relims now. Come on then.
Run with that down.
No, well, thank you for coming in and joining us on the podcast today. It's been a good to have you on with you.
No, thanks, boys. It's good.
I'm glad you're – good to hear the announcement too. South Tarree's back.
South, yeah.
If you know, depending on what happens with rep on us, but yeah. I reckon it's cool that you're –
No, I'm excited, so it'll be good for Tarree. Give Tarree a bit of a buzz now. And like I said, I went away and experienced professionalism with Knockout, and obviously I want to take that back to Tarree now. So,
yeah.
Be good, buzz.
Either way, it'll be a great weekend.
100%. It's always beautiful. Beautiful set of mob. Like I said, it's like Christmas Day, eh? Big corroboree.
Black Christmas.
Hey.
Love it. All right. Thanks for tuning in.